It is a remarkable fact, but I actually owned a copy of Turing's paper, which in fact I wrote and got from him when it was published in the Royal Society, because I'd known, of course, Turing's name from computing via the von Neumann, but I hadn't realised that he'd done this. So when I saw this, I actually have the copy somewhere. And it's quite interesting because later when he died, his mother found my address amongst his papers. Mm-hmm. And she actually wrote to me saying that she'd found this and so on. And it is, in fact, through that and my connection with King's College that I got involved in the Turing Trust, because Turing was a fellow of King's. And in fact, it was through this organization that we got his life written by Andrew Hodges, the book called The Enigma, and which was very, very successful, and I think a very interesting book. And I had, of course, looked, when I say read, I mean looked at Turing's paper, which, of course, I wasn't too au fait with the equations that he'd done, but that they were diffusion equations as well. And, of course, it's a very interesting paper because it's, if you could think of Turing as being the archdeacon of digital computation, which he was, in his Turing machine and in everything that followed in computers, this stuff was exactly the opposite. It is essentially an analogue computation. And that's an analogue computation with thresholds and the sort of thing that cells are and objects are very good at doing. And of course, it is interesting that this separation between digital and analog thinking really swept through biological sciences. And I think a lot of the analog computation was just forgotten because of the, I think for a lot of things like computers were digital, genetic programs were like computer programs. It's all this kind of thinking by metaphor or thinking by similarity, by analogy, that I think confused a lot of people. Because our biological systems have worked out extremely good ways of doing analog computation within their scales and do it exceedingly well. And in fact, they find it very difficult to count things beyond one. They can count the difference between one and nought. I think that Turing then had shown that there's an engineering solution, if I can put it that way. And it is interesting that Lewis himself had been trained as an engineer, and so this, I think, did come naturally to him, that this is kind of machinery that doesn't count, but has thresholds and has flows and organises things in that way.